Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you so much for joining me today for this session. I'm really excited to be sharing with you about how to build your own augmented reality. Some of it is for Merge Cubes and some of it is just to use on a device. My name is Sue Carter and I am coming to you from the Northern Territory. I'm based in Darwin. And I have been part of the CESA program over the last 5 years. So let's get started. We're using Zoom today, and I just wanted to familiarize you with the tools. We have a microphone on the left-hand side. So can you make sure that it stays muted unless you'd like to ask questions during question time? We've also got the video button, and you might like to keep that off until we're asking questions. Please use the chat facility, and during the session, Celia will be posting some of the links into the chat. We'll have a bit of a poll at some stage, and if you'd like to react to anything, there's that little reactions button as well. So first of all, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land in which we're meeting on today, both we work, we live, and to recognise their continuing connection to land, water and community. I'd like to pay my respects to elders that are past, present and for the future. I come to you today from the Larrakia land and that of the Larrakia people, the saltwater people. As I mentioned earlier, I'm part of the CESA program, and this has been funded by the Australian Government Department of Education. And we've had project offices over the last few years across the country, sharing all things digital technologies curriculum. We have a range of online courses, and if you haven't had the opportunity to start one of those, I'd like to encourage you to explore cesamoocs.adelaide.edu.au. And please feel free to sign up for our newsletter. We still send these out. You'll also notice that there's a lending library section, and I'll be telling you more about this towards the end of our session today. We will be, during this session, interacting with the screen, and just wanted to bring to your attention your annotation tool at the top of your screen. You'll see you might need to mouse over to see view options, and right at the bottom of view options is the annotate option, and then a bar will come up and you'll be able to draw or stamp or arrow or even write some text if you want to onto the screen. So as I said to you, I am coming to you from Darwin today, and I'd just like to take this opportunity to ask people to mark on this map using that annotate tool where you're coming from today. So you can stamp with a star or a heart. I can see some names are popping up. Wow, so there seems to be a lot of people from Victoria there today.
Good inside day activity, Sue.
Ah, because it's awful weather for you, isn't it? Sorry, I'm just fixing something on my other screen here. That's it, beautiful. And some people from Queensland and some New South Wales. Okay, I thought I saw someone from Adelaide earlier join us as well. There you are, Leonie. All right, that's lovely. Thank you very much. Okay, now I've run a series of sessions on augmented reality, and just in case you've missed those and maybe some things today you're not really sure about, I'd just like to draw to your attention that on the CESA YouTube channel, we have a number of webinars, And the first one that I did was on augmented reality and the Merge Cube and the Merge Cube EDU apps. And we had a little bit of a play there. So I'd encourage you, if you're not familiar with any of that, to go to that particular recording and watch that. We've done a second one, and this one was around building some of your own augmented reality simulations. And we did that more with CoSpaces and Tinkercad. So today I've got a bit more of a focus on the Tinkercad side of things. So if you want to know more about CoSpaces and how that works, and particularly with the Merge Cube, then I would suggest watching that one. A couple of weeks ago, we did this session on some updates on the Merge Cube, its augmented reality, and what's happening next. So there was a new app, HoloGlobe, and we explored that and using the dashboard and all the updates and simulations that are there. So today, our outline, I'm just going to do a really, really quick review of augmented reality and Merge Cube. And then just mention what the apps are in case you're not familiar with them. Some connections with the Australian curriculum, because it's really important to understand what it is that we're teaching and why we're teaching it. And then we're going to look at how we create our own augmented reality, some resources to get you started, a little bit around the design thinking process, and then getting right into Tinkercad and looking at what's available there. And there've been some new updates in that space. And then look at some kits that are available. We've got augmented reality kits, Merge Cube kits and the like. So just a quick overview of augmented reality, understanding that it's how technology is used to superimpose some information into our real world environment. And it's usually viewed either through a mobile phone or through an iPad or some sort of device. And what it does is it provides this layer of content into our physical world. Some things have a trigger on them. It could be like a QR code or like on the Merge Cube, the silver markings on it. And then you can actually scan in an area and put your content into an area. And it's fantastic for students to actually interact with in a three-dimensional way where they can simulate something happening. So what is your experience with creating augmented reality? Because we're moving into a creation phase, I'd like to know those people that are there today, have you ever tried to create your own? Have you had a bit of a dabble in there? Yes, you have built some of your own, and yes, you've built it with students. So I'm just going to release a poll now for you. And I'll just go back to the previous one and launch that. Can you confirm that you can see the poll?
Yep, all good, sir.
Right. So we have one person that's never played around with it and five people that have had a dabble. I'll just end the poll at that point and share those results. There we go. So hopefully you can see on your screen where we're looking today. So that's great that we're going to launch into building your own and having a little bit of a dabble today. Thank you. So let's just recap on augmented reality in environments as adults. Augmented reality is a highly visual tool, and it offers anyone, students, adults, into an immersive experience where you can bring an object or a concept into our real world that would otherwise just be imagined. Or maybe it was inaccessible, or maybe it was difficult to grasp, or even to help some things that are invisible become visible. But most importantly, what it seems to be doing is really engaging our learners. So some examples for today that we see are in medicine and healthcare, where patient education, GP training, surgical visualizations, disease prevention simulations, there are a whole lot of apps out there that enable our health workers to look at the different opportunities of increasing medicine and healthcare. For instance, you know, we can use an AR app to find the precise locations of veins, enabling the professional to accurately draw blood or start an IV in the right place for a surgical procedure. It is offered in engineering. And in real estate, you may have experience on realestate.com that you're looking at houses and they're beautifully furnished, but quite often the furniture is actually augmented reality as well. Retail places are starting to use it. The example on the screen there is IKEA. If you go to their website, you'll be able to choose some furniture and then use their app and place it into your room to see, oh, is this going to go, or do I need a different colour, or is it the right size, those sorts of things. So it's really helping you to try before you buy picture. And I just heard before we started that Kmart have just launched their own app for a similar situation. It can be used in entertainment and in defence. See, even our military are starting to use different types of training scenarios to produce better soldiers. They've got some apps that improve their situational awareness and train them how to process information quickly and safely. You know, for example, they've got tactical augmented reality that provides tactical mapping during a military operation, helping soldiers to find who are the friendlies and who are the not so friendlies out there in the field. It's being used for space exploration, in manufacturing now, and even travel guides. I was looking at over the weekend how I can travel to different parts of Europe and start to see some things in an augmented reality way. But what about in education? What does augmented reality look like for our students? So there are a number of different apps that are available, and you can do some historical things. For instance, the BBC's Civilizations app allows you to bring different objects into the classroom. And here is an example of an Egyptian sarcophagus. So you can make it look like it's really there and transform their learning experiences. The Measure app, I don't know if you've used this, lots of adults seem to use this one now. It's a free app and you can actually measure up different spaces to work out the area of something, or if you want to do some building or add some furniture into a space and do things really fit. So that's a really good one to try out. And from a mathematical perspective, GeoGebra have an augmented reality app as well. It's free and it enables students to look at different planes and do different forms of measurement. So you can see there that there's a concrete object, and then next to it, you can actually put an augmented reality object. And then there are lots of science simulations. And look, augmented reality is so good for things like biology, for anatomy, for physics and chemistry, where students can actually start to pull things apart in an augmented reality way. And this example here with Frogipedia, it is a $3.99 app, but it does allow you to look at the life cycle of a frog, study the living animal, look at it, explore its organs and systems, understand some of the vocabulary, and even then go into the dissection of a frog as well. And then we move into storytelling. Augmented reality is now starting to move into that storytelling space. So, you know, when we were younger, we would delight in books that would open up, pop up in a three-dimensional sense. You can see the one at the bottom there, that's like a Peter Rabbit type of springtime picture, and it just folds open and you can see all the different animals and fairies and flowers. You know, all the top picture is a simple it opens up, and then you've got a flap and you can lift the flap up. So they were really exciting for us. But now we're moving into augmented reality using devices. So one example is if I were a wizard, it's probably more a bit more virtual reality than augmented reality, but it takes the students into Hazel's world. So Hazel is looking at her career and where she's going to end up in her lifetime. She actually wants to be a wizard. She wants to understand the power of magic. And so we follow her through her journey throughout a day, helping friends and family, solving problems and making the world a much better place. So you can go into her world and find out more. Or from a science perspective, there's a whole iExplore series of books, and their apps are free as well. And Into Deep Space takes the students into a world of what space looks like. There's lots of factual information in the books, but then when you use the app, things start to spring out and you start to see space as it really is. Or the brain, the iExplore brain, again, where you can actually look through the different parts of the brain. You can see the brain, it actually comes up, and you can see the different parts that light up in different circumstances. So those are actually available from our lending library as well. And I can show you more when we get towards the end there. Now, how does this all fit in with the Merge Cube picture? Well, Merge Cube is basically the trigger for the augmented reality. It's a 7x7x7 foam cube with silver markings on it. And when you download some of the apps and you're holding the cube in your hand with the device, then this thing comes to life. Basically, the augmented reality, the hologram, it's in your hand, and students are actually feeling what it's like in this virtual world to see this moving and understanding it better. You can have it on a desk in front of you rather than holding it, but it kind of really engages the students and they kind of want to know more. Look, if you don't have a Merge Cube, don't have to worry about that, because there is the paper one, and it's a lot of fun to make the paper one with your students as well. And that's at the mergecube.com paper PDF link. So I'd encourage you, if you haven't had a play with those, to give that a go as well. And just so you understand the apps that work with the cube, there's Merge Explorer, and that's the one with the simulations. And there are quite a number of those and some cards and activities. And then you've got the viewer, where you actually have objects, like we saw that sarcophagus before. There are a whole lot of objects. There's a lot of different options available to you, many different categories. There are flowers, there's museum exhibits, there's viruses, lots of different things that you can explore in that space. And of course, then we've got the Merge Holo Globe, and that's the new one that looks at NASA and NOAA technology and enables students to see the world in real time, looking at clouds and earthquakes and temperatures and vegetation and so on and so forth. So again, if you want to know more about this one, watch the 18th of May session that will be posted on our YouTube channel. And just to quickly recap, how does that work? You launch the app, you launch the simulation that you're interested in, you put it over the Merge Cube, and then you'll see this simulation and something actually happening, like a satellite that's traveling around the Earth in real time. Now, why are we doing all of this? Well, partly because it's so engaging for our students and really enhances their learning, but also looking at the Australian curriculum connections. Now, I've chosen to look at version 9 because I'm looking forward now. This has been released, and I like to share about what's happening in this space. So first of all, I wanted to highlight the digital literacy side, because we are using digital devices, we are using these simulations, we are using digital tools, and this is what the digital literacy, which was ICT capability, this is where we're selecting and we're using things and adapting to new ways in technology and trying to keep safe as well. But equally so, we've got our technologies learning area, and that's where we're creating solutions for things. And so that's why we're looking at designing our own augmented reality today, because we want our students to design some solutions, and we're looking at digital solutions when it comes to the augmented reality. But we're also thinking about our systems thinking, our design thinking, and our computational thinking in this space as well. So how do we go about creating augmented reality? There are many, many apps out there. I'm just bringing today to you, I think it's five or six that I wanted to share with you today. And the first one is AR Maker. And the reason why I'm showing you this is because this is really suited to our K-3 students, and it allows them to be creative. You can create your own scene in there. So it is like a blank canvas where students can start to develop their own things, or there are some pre-made things in there ready, and that's a really good starting point for them. Yes, they can bring in their own drawings or photographs into an interactive setting for their own storytelling. And in this space, you can bring in three-dimensional objects and place them into a physical space, and then they can start to tell a story. And the students can actually move around this space as well. Another option that's out there is Adobe Aero. This too, I think, is a free app, and a lot of schools are using the Adobe tools. And in Aero, it does have a number of characters but you are already in there, but you too can bring in your own characters. It is very quick and easy. Again, another blank space and perfect for the younger students, but also throughout primary and even early secondary, depending on where you're teaching and what your context is. So with AR Maker, I've just got an example here about reimagining the three little pigs through AR Maker, because it has the three pigs and a scene in there. So this is a really good one to start with. And what you do is you go to your surface and you can tap on your surface, pop your characters in there, and then you can put some real people in there, and then you can use the microphone and start to tell your story and share it. Now, this activity comes from Paul Hamilton. He works at Using Technology Better, and this is one of the examples that he's used in younger classrooms. So here's an example where you're in a setting outside, you've brought in all your different parts, and then what you would do is, once they've walked through that and done their scene, you would encourage students to build their own short story where they can add their own pictures or their own characters, their own drawings, and use other apps like Everyone Can Create. Now, looking at older students, Reality Composer is probably the one you want to go with. It's free. What's different about this one is it actually gives you a plane that you can work on. So you're going to choose your anchor. Do you want it to be flat on the ground, horizontal? Or are you thinking of artworks that might need to actually be up on the wall, and so you've got a vertical picture? You can actually put images into an environment, like into a poster or a book. Or you can do the face, augmenting your face in there as well. Very, very simple tool to use. You've got all your things that you can bring in. They're all categorized. And so you're going to bring your 3D objects into a space so you can see the shapes at the bottom there. But you can import your own into the space as well, which is really important, particularly if you've taken photographs. So the example I'm using today is a plate. I bought a plate into augmented reality, into the space. And it's really important to note that in this space, you can see all those little squares. Each square is 10 centimetres by 10 centimetres. So when you're doing some mathematical calculations, it's really good to know that you can do things to scale. And then the darker lines, that's actually a 1 metre by 1 metre square. So it's really good for students and their mathematical capabilities as well. So in the food section, I found some fruit, and what I did was then place the fruit out onto my plane, and then I'm picking up the fruit and I'm arranging it on the plate. You might be thinking, well, how can I use this in a classroom? And it might be as simple as you're creating a lunch or you're creating a dinner. What sort of things might you have on the plate? Or it might be a home economics class and you might be looking at different colours around food, or the different vegetables with the meats and trying to show healthy balancing with your food. Now, as you bring each item onto the plate, you can actually see it's in centimetres, so you can actually make it smaller or larger, and again, you're looking at those dimensions mathematically. So As you touch each item, you'll then get your different scales and your different planes. So you've got your up and down, you've got your moving left and right, and you've got your ability to swivel it around as well. So it gives that three-dimensional look. And then as you bring each piece on, you want to make sure that it's fitting on the plate as well. Added a cup of coffee as well, because here's breakfast. And then finally, I've saved this and I'm putting it into the real world. So here's the example of it inside on a desk. So that's something simple like Reality Composer and how that can be used. I'm going to move into CoSpaces now. And CoSpaces connects with Merge Cube. So the other ones I've shown you are just augmented reality and they're not linked to the Merge Cube, but CoSpaces is one that allows you to project your hologram onto the Merge Cube. And the way you do that is by choosing a scene, and you have three options. You have your three-dimensional environment and you're working around that, just like we saw in Reality Composer. Or you can have a 360 image, which means you can actually move right around it yourself. But the one we're focusing on here is Merge Cube. And so it would be the bottom option there. And then it's really important that you understand when the Merge Cube is there, well, which is up, which is down, which is left, which is right. So it's a good idea to right-click on it to show your side labels. So you can spin it around and see the top, the bottom, the right, the front, the back, the left, and so on in that way. But you can also create inside the Merge Cube. And so with your labels, you'll be able to see what's the bottom, what's the back, and what's the right, and what's the left as well. So when you're building a scene, it's lovely that you can build the scene on the cube, or you can build the scene inside the cube, or you can build the scene around the cube so you can see something that's happening. Now, CoSpaces have some great tools, and I'll just go back. And I'm not going to go into depth with this one today because the second series on augmented reality in our YouTube channel actually goes into CoSpaces in great detail. But basically, you have a library and you have a whole lot of things within your library. You have lots of objects, but you can upload your own if you want to. So you can create something in another space and upload it. When you choose an object, like I've chosen a dog, what will happen is it will appear, and when you click on it, you'll have the option to rotate it around, to drag it up and down, to scale it in and out, or to use your translation mode. And when you do that, You'll also have some options to code your animal, to add some speech to it, even to animate. There are some animations there, or you can make up your own animations. You can recolor it and transform it as well. So here's my dog, and when it's on play, he's actually moving around, thinking bark and going woof. And CoSpaces, I found these projects at Games for Change, student challenges, and there are teachers' resources there. So I'm thinking, well, if I've never used this, where am I going to start? So I thought this would be a good PDF for people to get hold of. And the first project in there is all about me. And what you're doing is you're putting something on the face of each of the cube, and you've got a character at the top. So this is a really lovely space for some students to start, particularly at the beginning of the year when you're getting to know one another. Then there's a VR roller coaster option. So the next project is where students learn how to do some programming using the camera and using the workspace and manipulating areas so it can twist and turn on a roller coaster track. Then you can move into the game side of things. So this one is the floor is lava, and so it's a game, and when things fall, you know, you get so many lives. So students love playing games, but maybe we want them to start designing their own games. And then finally, build your own impact game, build a project yourself. Now that you've learned all these different elements of CoSpaces, what can you design for yourself? And this booklet actually goes through all the different stages, page by page. It gives the teacher what they need to do step by step. There are also a few other augmented reality classroom resources out there that I found. This one is from Apple, and it gives you a range of different augmented reality options that you can try with different AR apps. So if you could pop that into the chat, Celia. And Apple also have a PDF that gives you some more information and lesson ideas on augmented reality in education. So I want to move now into the design thinking process, because as we're moving into Tinkercad and as we're moving to the creation side of things, we need to think about, why are we doing this? What is the design process that we're going to use? I wanted to share this one with you today. It's actually from Questacon, and they use it in their engineering is elementary workshops. And so firstly, it's that ask side of things. Ask some questions, empathize, find out what it is where people are having a problem or a solution that needs to be created. And then you imagine, what could you do? Let some creativity start to happen about how you might overcome some of these problems. Then you go into the planning phase, followed by the creation phase, and then you'll prototype it, and then test it out. How did it work? Can I improve it? So just note that this is an engineering design process as opposed to a design process, design thinking. And I particularly like this one, which is the same five steps, but they use different words. And you'll see a lot around the empathize, the define, the ideate, the prototype, and the test. So again, we're exploring the problem or the user's environment. We're trying to find out as much as we can about what it is that is the problem. And then we're going to come up and define it. Then we're going to brainstorm, come up with lots of possibilities, then we'll prototype it, we'll build it, we'll find out if this is going to work or not, then we'll test it out. And then I've thrown in there number six, the iteration, because it's really important to improve on your design and test again. Now, I can't remember his name, Dyson, the man who developed the Dyson vacuum cleaner, the bagless vacuum cleaner. He had something like 5,221 prototypes and tests before he actually got to his final design. So it's really important for students to understand the first time isn't always going to be the best one, and maybe we can improve and make sure that it's meeting the needs of our users. This one is from Maker's Empire. This is their design thinking process. Again, very similar, where you empathize, you define, you ideate, you do the prototype, you test, and then I've got repeat. And for me, repeat is reflection. What is it that worked? What didn't work? What do I need to change or add? That sort of thing. So how does this look like though in a classroom? So last week I was at a Maker's Empire design thinking challenge, and they used the Pringles as the prompt. And so the group was asked, what do you know about Pringles? Think about your first encounter you had with Pringles. Remember a time when you've eaten some Pringles and, you know, do you know people that like them or don't like them? What's a funny, embarrassing Pringles moment that you may have experienced? So as a group, we would have these conversations, the first part of our process. And what we discovered were there were a few problems. People started to talk about the fact that you couldn't get your hand into the top to get the Pringles out. Others mentioned that I want to use it to dip, but I've got to take like 4 or 5 Pringles to do that because they're so thin that they snap. Others talked about when you get to the bottom of the can, they're all broken. One other lady mentioned that she pulled some out of the fridge of her accommodation and opened it, and they were empty because the previous person had eaten them and then put the empty packet, making it look like it hadn't been used, back into the refrigerator so they didn't have to pay for their Pringles. So it was really interesting listening to everybody's encounters and experiences and what was working and what wasn't working with Pringles. Oh, another group said, well, I bought the red ones thinking that they were tomato or chili, but they were actually plain. But when I buy Smith's chips or Arnott's chips, the plain ones are blue. So there's something about the packaging and the colouring, and maybe there should be something a little bit more universal. So all the groups went away and worked on their particular problem that they had, and then they had to come up with some solutions and write 10 ideas, let your imagination run wild, and then we would choose 3 and we would share them, and then we would pick one and then we would prototype the one. And it was really interesting to see the different ideas that people came up with. So one group came up with the fact that you might be able to 3D print an insert into the tube so that instead of not being able to get your hand in, you could actually slide this item out and eat your Pringles and then slide it back in again. Another group came up with 3D printing the shape of a Pringle in plastic. And so it would be at the top and it would be a specific colour, and you'd be able to get your dip and put it on the Pringle so that your Pringle was less likely to snap. Or there was another group that had a plunger and they would push it up underneath, and then you'd be able to take your Pringles out from the top. So lots of different ideas in the room of around 25 people. And I thought it was a really good way of thinking about, so something as simple as Pringles, but going through this process and what you can come out with at the end. So how does that fit with creating augmented reality? Tinkercad is a great free app and online available 3D developing space, basically. Now, what's interesting is I only found out over the weekend that there are 3 parts to Tinkercad. There's the 3D design, which is the part I've always used. Then there's the electronics area where you can look at, there's the design. So here's a marine ecosystem, and a students do dioramas. Well, here's an opportunity of doing it in a digital format. And then you've got the electronics. So instead of having to buy a whole set of different electronics. You can test things out in this space first, work out what connects, what works, what doesn't work, before you're actually then doing it with the concrete. And then they've got the coding area, and their code blocks are the same as Scratch. So if your students are familiar with Scratch, they won't have a problem with the Tinkercad code blocks as well. Now, Tinkercad has a gallery of different ideas. So, you know, what am I going to do? Again, I showed you that Pringles example. So you could start to think about, well, if I'm in there, what is my purpose? Remembering what is expected in the curriculum as well, but what's my purpose in developing some augmented reality? Because we want to design something or create something for a particular reason. So, for example, here's the geometry city, and the students were asked to redesign things for their city. Imagine. What could you have? Different playgrounds, different museum looking things, different gymnasiums. And the students came up with this idea, and you were able to build it in Tinkercad and then put it into the augmented reality picture, lay it on a Google map. This is what it might look like. And then you can start to play with different shapes and colours and moving around and if something would work or not work. So there's a gallery in there, and there's lots of different ideas within the gallery in the designs. And then there's the ones for circuits, and then the ones for code blocks as well. So students have these opportunities to actually start to be creative. The 3D water cycle and what that looks like, building something like the horse stables, which is a collaborative project, which I'll explain how that works, or having puppets on the stage and what that might look like. So if you're building in Tinkercad, it's interesting and it's a little bit different to the Reality Composer. So up here in your corner, you'll see a cube, which has like the merge cube, the top, the front, the sides and so forth. When you move that, that's when your work plane actually moves up and down, sideways, rotating. And you can see on mine, I've put merge cube there because that's what I built. And over here, you'll see that I'm using the 3D design. There is an option for blocks and bricks. I haven't used those yet. I've only focused on the 3D design side of things. And the first one you'll see there are the basic shapes, but you don't have to use shapes. There are lots of other things that you can bring in, like creatures and characters and vehicles and structures and scenery. So it's not just limited to shapes, but that is where students tend to start, by building things using different shapes. And again, it's bringing those mathematical concepts into your design as well. Now, how does this fit with the merge cube? So what Tinkercad have an export button. And so when you create something, like I did the merge cube text, I can export that into the object viewer. So object viewer, remember, was one of those Merge Edu apps, and it's where you've got a whole lot of different objects and you can take them into the real world. The advice is to export it as an OBJ file, an object file. And when you export it, you can then download it to your device and then upload it into Object Viewer. However, Tinkercad have connected up with a number of different services. And now you can send it to Merge Edu directly, or Thingiverse, or Kai's Clan, or any of these other ones on the screen. So this is new and fascinating. And if you are logged in to your Merge Edu app or on their website in your dashboard, when you send to Merge Edu, it will automatically upload into your Merge dashboard. So you can see where I've highlighted Object Viewer, and you can see a copy of the Coolinari is importing directly in there. Now, and then of course you use CoSpaces for your Merge Cube side of things, as I showed in session two. Now, something that's really new and fascinating is that you can collaborate in Tinkercad. And you saw that one earlier, that was the whole stables, that was a collaborative project. So in the toolbar where the person is with the add sign, you can invite people to design with you. And the way you go about that is you click on the button, and for the very first time for collaborate, it'll say first time sharing this design, so generate a new link. You click on that, and then this comes up saying share this link either in an email or instant message. So what you do is you copy the link and you send it to your colleague or your buddy at school, and then the students can go in and collaborate and build together. So this is new and fascinating within Tinkercad. Can I also point out that in the last 12 to 24 months, Tinkercad have now got their teach resources side of things happening. Now, because of COVID and lockdowns and students learning from home, they've created a whole heap of lesson plans. And down the side here, you can see there are 11 categories to choose from. I clicked on the design one, and here are some examples, skatable art, designing a flood solution, creating a wheelchair for difficult terrain, creating solar-powered inventions. So there's a whole heap of things in there. I've chosen the one, create your own avatar, because this might be a good starting point with your students using the different shapes to create an avatar. So what it does is it gives you a bit of a description, and then it goes through a lesson plan. And there are different steps within the lesson plan. They give you an overview, then how to set up your class, and then they go through the designing your avatar, finding the traits, learning to draw in 2D, drawing the avatar, measuring up your design, building the 3D blocks using Tinkercad, working the shapes, building your avatar in 3D, and then sharing your avatar. And it steps you through each of those processes along the way. Absolutely fascinating. So ideas, what else could you do? I found this one on the gingerbread, and I hope you'll be able to hear the sound, because I think I may have forgotten to share the sound. But I sort of thought, well, you could take this into another realm. Let's just see if this plays and you hear sound. Can you confirm that the sound is working, please, Celia?
I can't hear it, but I can pop the link into the chat and people could watch it.
I'm just going to stop sharing for a second. Sorry, everyone. I'll share again. I'll just click the sound. There we go. Right, this should work.
In this video, we will show you how...
Does that work? Okay. Oh, press play.
To transform gingerbread house building from a fun activity into an awesome STEM challenge. We will also show ways you can modify the challenge to make it easier or harder. The basic challenge is simple. Design and build a gingerbread house that won't fall over. That sounds easy. But it can take a little problem solving to make sure you don't end up with a crumbly, sticky mess. Let's break it down into three engineering steps: designing, building, and testing. Step 1 is designing the gingerbread house. Start by setting a few basic criteria for the gingerbread house you will build. For example, the house must have four walls and a roof, or the house must stand upright. If you want to make it more challenging, you can add additional criteria like the house must have a chimney, have cut-out windows, have a balcony, include at least one circle, rectangle, square, and triangle, be at least 2 floors tall, or have any other architectural features you choose. If you want to make this gingerbread house building challenge a competition, you can assign points for different design elements and costs for various building materials. Who can design a gingerbread house with the highest score? Once the design requirements are clear, sketch your gingerbread house plan. Next, it is time to build the gingerbread house. Lay out the building materials. Using graham crackers.
Now, you'll see that in this one, they're actually using food, but I felt that this is where you could bring your Tinkercad into it and you could actually build it within Tinkercad itself. But there's nothing to say you can't do it with food if you want to as well.
Crackers in place of gingerbread can be a huge time saver. You will need royal icing to use as glue to stick everything together, and an assortment of candies for decoration. Think about what you need to do first to build your gingerbread house. In what order should you put together your walls, roof, and other architectural elements? How can you stabilize your house as you build it? Use piping bags with tips or resealable plastic bags with a corner cut off to apply royal icing to hold your house together. As you work, review your gingerbread house. Does it meet all design criteria? The final step before decorations can begin is testing your gingerbread house. Testing can be as simple as making sure your gingerbread house stands up and doesn't fall over when you're done building it. If you want to add more difficulty, you can do a stability test and use a shake table to simulate earthquakes of different strengths. Or you can use a fan or hairdryer to simulate a hurricane. Can your gingerbread house withstand these forces? Don't get frustrated if your house collapses while building or falls apart during testing. Testing and observing your design allows you to identify weak spots that can be fixed. Maybe you need to add more icing to hold your pieces together, or you need to add structural support to certain features. The process of repeatedly designing, building, and testing is called iteration and is used by real engineers to find the best possible design solution. Once you have the structure of your gingerbread house stable, it is time to decorate it.
And I'll leave that there. So the reason I wanted to show you that was because this looks like a fabulous challenge to do. Obviously talking about gingerbread, and I was thinking like Hansel and Gretel sort of thing, but you could do a similar thing with the three pigs and the different houses that they built. You might do something with the bears, you know, the three bears and building their house, or Goldilocks, Red Riding Hood or something like that. But you could take it one step further and actually think, well, that's all very nice from those fairy tales, but what are the scientific elements I can bring in? For example, can your house, can you design something that can withstand strong winds or strong storms or a cyclone, or make it flood resistant for those particular characters from those stories? So the kind of ideas and things to think about that you might like to consider moving forward with Tinkercad.
Hi, this is Svenja Lohner from Science.
Right. Looks like I was playing around there with animations. So I'm going to put up another poll now, because I've gone through a bit about Maker, very briefly about Aero, Reality Composer, and then CoSpaces and Tinkercad. And I've only really given you a snapshot today of each of these and the opportunities. I'd be interested to know from the little bits and pieces that I presented, and depending on your context and what age group you're teaching, I'd be interested to know which one of these apps would interest you the most. So I'm just going to launch the poll. There we go. So I'll give you a few moments. So we've got one person, two, three, 4. Okay, there we go. That's very interesting. I'm going to share those results. There we go. So 25% each person is looking at one of those particular ones. So that's fantastic. Thanks everyone for that. Right. So now we're going to go into activity time. So before we do, I'd just like to check the chat and how things are going with the chat. Are there any questions in there, Celia?
There was just one earlier when you were first talking, and Leonie wanted to know, can you video the object in Merge Cube apps? I presume that means can you video what you're seeing? Can you record the image? Which Leonie might clarify the question a bit more.
I haven't used a video option in the Merge apps, but there are animations with the characters in there. What would be interesting, I'm trying to think through that. I'm sure there's a video option. If not, you use your camera and video. I'd have to go back and double check.
Fair enough. Tony said that you used to be able to, but we haven't checked the most.
Yeah.
Good question. We don't even know 100% sure.
Yeah.
That was the only one so far.
Okay. All right. So what I wanted people to do now, it is almost 5 o'clock. And so now you can either have a go with this activity that I've got on the next couple of slides, or I'll just finish up for today. So it's up to the group. If you could indicate in the chat if you're interested in having a bit of a play. Oh, 5:30 your time, yes. So, yeah, if people could just post in the chat if they would like to have a go at the activity or if you'd like me to finish up. So Chantel wants to have a play. Great. Okay, Leonie, you've got to go. That's fine. What I'll do is I'll quickly finish up the last little bits and then I'll come back to the activity. Oh, good. Sam's happy to play. Excellent. All right. I'll just move through these quickly.
So if you do that, then I'll stop the recording later. Great.
Yeah, after that. Yeah, okay. So the lending library at our csmoocs.adelaide.edu.au website, we have a lending library there, and there's things on Merge Cubes, and there's augmented reality, and there's virtual reality, and there's AI as well. So I would encourage people to go there and have a look and borrow something. And don't forget the courses that we have that are available, and there's teaching AI in the classroom and cybersecurity awareness. And we'd really like some feedback on our webinar today. So, Celia, if you could put that bit.ly link into the chat, it would be great for some feedback. And we ask people, please keep in touch through our newsletter, through our Facebook, through Twitter, and through YouTube. So thanks, Leonie. I know that you have to go. I'm going to go back to here and go through the activity with these people. Celia, do you want to turn the recording off now?
Sure will.
Thank you.
Just get the feedback one in. I put it in and it hasn't become a link. So,
okay. All right. So if people want to have a play with Tinkercad,